I will be covering a area which is evolution of cybersecurity strategy. If we have to have a strategy for the country, how we should bucket it, and this is up for discussion and inputs. There are a couple of areas and ideas which I have put together, but we can all debate. I'll try to skip a lot of slides because we have already discussed, and let's not talk about what happens. We all know all this connections and all that, motivations. But I think if you look at ITU and they do this study every year, one thing in other ranking, our ranks are going up, but in cybersecurity index, as a country, we are really going down from 5th to 23rd and 47th. I remember 2 years back, 3 years back, when we did this analysis, some 50 or 60 countries have their strategies and all. We were one of them. We were the in 2013, we came up with our strategy. But I think the area where we are not good at as a country is implementation and the enforcement. That's the biggest challenge which I have said. We have a lot of laws in the country. I don't know what happens on ground. So same thing over here. So there are a lot of countries which have picked up. And the best part is once they have something in place, the enforcement is very good on ground. We are opposite. We are good in coming up with the guidelines and the baselines, but on ground, things may not be great. So what we have seen is, this is one of the slides where I want to spend some time. When we look at we looked at some 50, 60 various countries, how they structure their cybersecurity strategies, what need to be covered, the common themes which comes out across. One is common set of objectives. It's a high priority. And the critical infrastructure identification. These are the common threads, common features which come across all the countries. There is some variation here and there, but these are the common threads. Within the common threads, the clear-cut message is we need to maintain a safe and resilient cyberspace for the nation. We need to create protect the critical infrastructure of the country. We need to have regulatory framework, legal framework, assurance framework, cyber awareness, CERT, technology, public-private partnership. So these are some of the common objectives which each country from a strategy perspective would like to do. And then when we get into the budgets and priorities are defined that at what level, which room we are talking about cybersecurity, what are the funds and resources you have allocated to that particular subject. And we were talking about the US alone, and that's the point which we were discussing. I remember initially when we looked at it, the Homeland Security was saying some $10 billion is what they spend every year on cyber. I did some Googling some time back, and then they said it's $17 billion. I was like surprised. In the last 3 years, they have just added $7 billion spending on cyber for only the government sector per se, because from a homeland one. So if I just pick up top five countries, we're talking about somewhere about $25 billion spending for the government alone. Forget about the industry. So the point over here is how you put priorities around. And if you are investing a dollar, then a seriousness comes in. When you're talking at a PMO level, there's a department who's pushing, there is an agency, a nodal agency doing that, then obviously it will come up. And then obviously there are countries which have defined critical sectors. Some may have five sectors, 10 sectors. That's a different story. But yes, the countries, they have realized that yes, we need to have critical infrastructure which are required for the country. And then what are the various measures which need to do? So whatever we discuss, I'm doing a follow-up what Atul mentioned. From a strategy perspective, I think there are four buckets which we need to talk about. And in these four buckets, the entire design, implementation, enforcement has to come in. The first one is, how can I secure my government ecosystem? How can I protect my government departments, critical infrastructure, whatever comes in, how can I do that? Is there a nodal agency? Is there awareness trainings between the government staff, users? All that goes into the securing the government ecosystem. The second one is, as a government, they have a role to play. The role is, how can I create a secure business ecosystem in the country? How can I help enterprises to work in a country? what type of liaisoning I can do within the regulators, how can I exchange information between various sectors, and how can I create that ecosystem in the country? That's the role of a government, which they need to play, so that the business, the small, medium enterprise, they can all work with some peace that, yes, from a cyber perspective, we have support available from the government. The third one we are talking about, how can I create a secure, cyber-secure society? Unless and until citizen is aware, we will not be able to create any of these. So we believe creating a secure society is the fundamental block in the overall strategy. And the fourth piece is, how can I build capacity both from human and technology perspective, which means how can I promote R&D in the country? How can I promote indigenous? How can I promote startups, cybersecurity startups? I'm talking about cybersecurity over here. And how can I create skilled workforce in the country? And these is across all levels, government, private, student, IT users, across. So these are the four building blocks under which we need to work around. That's how we believe need to be structured. And obviously, when you have to do that, you need to look at the complete life cycle, both from proactive and reactive perspective. That is all given. Now, from a secure government system perspective, if I have to talk about, what are we talking about? So there has to be some objective for this particular building block, which is that how can I strengthen the overall government ecosystem to do efficient delivery to the citizens, service delivery. So take any of these central ministries, state ministries, any of these departments, how can I secure my overall ecosystem so that I have efficient delivery to the citizens? And I can take multiple examples in this area. So I remember that we were in one of the state, went in, and for last four days their data center was down, and they were not bothered the way they should be. And they were just pushing that now we will have another 10% penalty to the service provider, systems are not working, it's a 5 crore penalty, 2 crore penalty. And incidentally, I was also interacting with one of the person who went for a registry. He wanted to get his land registered, and he flew from US. He was here for 4 days, but the systems were not working because there was an attack, ransomware attack, and the systems were down. I'm just saying that this is one of the area, and these are practical examples from ground which are coming in. So the second objective is, as a government, if we look at it, and that's what I was talking in the morning also, that government is the only sector in the globe which collect, process 8 billion records of the individuals. In India alone, we're talking about 15% approximately PII information is with the government because of our population size. So if that's the case, how we talk about the sensitivity which is associated with it? And it is PI, it's a biometric, PHI, everything comes in, right? So how can we have that objective? I'm just trying to put objectives, and there's no right or wrong answer that what we need to do. I'm saying if we need to have a clear vision, what we want to do in that particular building block, then we will move towards that direction. That's how we thought we will put together. And if something happens, then how we quickly come out of it? What is the incident response, comprehensive end-to-end that can come in? Again, I can put down an example because I work very extensively. So there was one of the client, one of the government department, we know them, we were doing some IT work for them, and cyber was not there. And so there was the website got defaced. So we told the client, sir, anything you need, we need to, our site is defaced and all that. They said, that's okay, please format and reinstall it. So the challenge is that how can we come up with a comprehensive incident response plan around it? So, but these are some of the examples on this. And when we need to address that, we need to have nodal body in the country. As of now, if you talk about, we have NCIPC, we have CERT, we have NTRO, MHA is trying to do something. So regulators are there. How can I have a single nodal body who owns that particular area? And obviously there was a lot of debate that cyber is a meaty subject or MHA subject. We have seen that and there are two different policies which the states and the department need to comply to, whether they need to comply to meaty guidelines or they need to comply to MHA guidelines, which guidelines we need to comply to. So they need to be very clear. Their understanding is very limited, the departments, right? So on top of it, if we have multiple guidelines going back to them, they're confused. You have a crisis management guideline coming in, you have ISO guideline coming in, you have CERT guideline coming in. So every now and then, we have a new strategy guideline baseline going to them. So the point is, if you tell me one step to do, I'll do that. But let's be very clear what is that step. So that's the reason we are saying, how can we have a nodal body who governs and monitors the cybersecurity of the government agency? Then continuous monitoring of the government. So this is very interesting. So I don't know what's your feel that how many of these departments, they actually monitor their systems from a security perspective, because some of them are dated. And if you go and enable logs on them, they will die down, some of the systems. So how can we do a centralized continuous monitoring of these systems and deploy security tools and technologies around it? And then obviously there are various areas and tracks on which one has to focus on. Now we were discussing about what are the key levers from a government perspective. So from our perspective, these are the five levers from a government piece. One is the lead responsible authority to drive it. There's a large set of cooperation which has to happen within the department, within the ministry, within one room and another room, within the country and outside country. So that's one. And then the capacity building for the government, that if they have people. Now I remember for last two years, MeitY is trying to run that program of awareness, and they're doing roles and responsibilities of the CISOs, and that's a very good step. And but so far they have completed some 500 participants training. For a country like 1.3 billion, we're just talking about 500, but the number is good. At least they have started, but there's a lot of ground which need to be covered, and how can we do that? The another one is legal measure. There is the IT Act, which is there in the country. Coming out with the Act, we were the first few countries. In 2000, we had an Act, we had an amendment, but are we up to mark? There are changes need to be done. So what is the legal measure which we have in the country to drive that? And then obviously the technical measures from a CERT perspective, how they work along. So, and all these five drivers, they need to work in collaboration. They can't work in silos. So we did a lot of research, and what other countries are doing, are there anything which we can learn from other countries? And obviously I'll skip that, but these are some of the ideas which we have put together. And I've not put down the priorities, but we said baseline, that's what we said. Why can't we have a baseline which can be followed across? So on this is fine. And some of the ideas is, why can't government mandate ISPs that you need to give a clean traffic, clean pipe to those citizens? I'm just thinking aloud, if one need to be done, that how can I do that for the citizen at large? If we work with the ISPs, or if ISPs work to create the awareness for the end user, they can do that. But one need to be clear that what need to be done and who need to do that. So application security, CERT, we have one CERT for last couple of years. We are trying to set up sectoral CERTs, state CERTs. Something is happening, but I think again the legal framework around it, which as a country we are trying to enhance and update, but some of those still need to be in place. And building capacity, so one of the ideas we were discussing is the challenges are different when I talk about the sector. So today I'm looking at forest, and tomorrow I'm looking at cyber. As a ministry or a department, can I have a different cadre, the way you have IRS officers, the way you have IS officers? Can I have a different cadre who looks after cyber? And if we can retain them for a longer duration in that particular ministry or a department, and if they move out, I've seen a lot of good and senior bureaucrats who are very keen on cyber. They were able to cover some grounds, but then they moved to another department. Now it's died down. So how can we create a different cadre, or how can I create a capacity and capability in that? So from a business environment perspective, although we have laws which are coming in, I'll skip it. Everyone in this room knows about it. But I think this is a debate we were doing prior to this, that we have regulators, we have government, we have sectors, how they can work together to drive something. So our view is as follows. So the standard bodies, first thing is the regulator. They are focusing on their primary responsibility is to create strong regulation and a baseline for that particular sector. That's it. Now, standard bodies need to define, because sometimes when the technology comes up, it's very difficult for a regulator to focus on that, because there's a lot of work on that. When you have standard bodies like STQC or Bureau of Indian Standards, can they adopt standards? Our view is that when we have these standards coming in, the challenge which we have seen is in terms of the sustenance and the maintenance of it. We can come up with something, and then tomorrow we come up with something different. The constant push happening on that particular piece, that element is missing in the country. And whenever these bodies work together, they work in isolation. So we don't have academia coming in, we don't have industry body coming in, law enforcement is at a different scale altogether, right? So whatever is happening, they have no limited visibility, and whatever is happening in the law enforcement, the other sectors have a limited. So if the standard bodies need to work together, how can they engage together to work on this? So these are some of them, and obviously I'll skip so that we can have more discussions. So on the creating a secure society is what was the third pillar we were talking about. And then from an objective perspective, we look at it, that how can I create a secure online environment for the citizens in the organizations? And this can be done. So I don't think that's a difficult task to doing it, but how can I run a national-wide cybersecurity awareness? And that's the point we said, is there a regulatory body whose role is only to create awareness? So this is what we were saying, that now RBI is also running some of the awareness campaign for the banking customer. TRAI comes up with something, but a clear-cut message is not going to the citizen at large. So how can I do that? And what is the best mode of reaching out? So we believe these SMS and all that, they may not be effective on ground. And we were discussing in one of the state, and they said, maybe why can't I start involving my end block or a village to create that awareness? And then they said, why can't we have a Nukkad Nataks on cyber per se? Then, because the point is you have to enforce a message back to them, and it has to be done by masses. So how can I do that? And these are some of the areas which we believe need to be addressed if we need to create that secure society. Obviously, that's a process I will skip through. And I'm so I think the ISPs, and these are again some of the steps we listed down, the ISP has a very large role to play, because we believe the touch point for a citizen is through the ISP. If I'm connected on a digital, that means somehow I'm connected on either on my landline, in my broadband or my phone, somewhere I need to be connected to ISP, and they have a very large role to play. So how can I get the ISPs onboarded to create an awareness? Because if you have to cover that large population, even if you create a regulator, we will not be able to do that. So what are the various bodies, agencies, which I onboard so that I can do this in a very effective manner? And what Gautam said, that how can I from a college level or a school level start doing cyber awareness and trainings? And it is starting happening. And last week I was in one of the school, and there was an inter competition between schools, and from 9th to 12th the students prepared video of some 7 to 8 minutes on cyber on privacy and cybersecurity. It was amazing to get their perspective on it, but it has started happening. But it was in a metro, it was in a Delhi, so that's the reason it happened. But what are we talking about? This is less than 1% of the student population in the country. So how can I go to tier 2, tier 3 villages to do this? And then as a country, we run various yoga day, we run various student day, we run various days and weeks and month. Why can't we just run a cyber awareness one day in a year for citizens to get the understanding? We do so many melas, nukkad natak and all that. Why can't we have something on cyber? And these are some of the ideas. I don't know how much we will be able to implement on ground, but we thought we'll list down. Some of them may work, some of them may not work. But we need to explore them to make it happen. The fourth pillar which we need to work on is the capacity building. We don't have cyber skill in the country. And someone, an IT guy spending 6 weeks or 6 months doing some administration of a cyber product, he's a cyber expert next day, and he will start writing, and every 6 months he keep on jumping the jobs. So we need to see how can we create cyber skill in the country. This will help not only from an India perspective, but we can also support the globe. And obviously the demand is across the globe. How can we start supporting from the country? So skill is one. The another piece was more we wanted to touch upon was on the indigenous R&D and cyber product developments. We have seen the challenge that whenever we have these procurements, the government departments or any of those departments, they want to have a product which is tested. Coming in. But why can't we have a mechanism where we start promoting our Indian products? Although there are various schemes which says you have to do it, but it is not effective on ground. And there are various reasons. So I think first, as a government, and this is the point which I touched upon, that money has to come in. But why the money has come in? Why, as a government, I can say that as of now, I don't have any security? You have a product, why can't you come in and test? If I start sharing even that platform with the startup, it's of a great help to that particular startup company. So they don't need my experience is that if I give them an option to startups, cyber startups, security startups, that I can give you seed funding, or I can give you a platform or experience or exposure, why don't you come and implement a product in large scale deployment, I'm sure they will pick up the second. So why can't we start promoting that in the country? Obviously, there has to have some framework which need to come in. I am not saying that from day one you start doing it at a critical infrastructure or critical infrastructure, but not less critical. Why can't I start doing that? And this will create security products where we don't have these challenges that I have a product coming in from a different country, I don't know whether it's secure, not secure. If I do that, I have a full control over it. So, and we, if you look at Israel and all, I was in one of the conference last year in RSA, and Israel government has a booth in that where they say that these are 80, you don't have to go to startups. I will help you to get those products back to you as a government. So I'm saying we can pick up some of them in our country and promote our products. So both, one is how can I create capacity, human capacity? How can I create a technology capacity, indigenous products around it? And there are a lot of examples we looked at doing that globally. Funding, entrepreneurship, how can I meet a demand and supply? Why can't I start creating an ecosystem where private can also come in and start supporting the government? Individual, in the individual capacity, why not? Why only the companies? I can start doing that, and there is a very good example which I picked up. So whenever there's any investigation, they have onboarded some people, they can come and support the investigator, law enforcement agency doing these exercises. So some of the measures which we listed down, that we do a lot of we say that we need a lot of funding doing all this, but if we identify, and this is one of the idea we were trying to put in, that you have a lot of colleges, state colleges, why can't we create a centralized infrastructure where the students and the teacher can play around on cyber? And nothing much will, it will not take a lot of resources and the budget, right? So one lab you set up for application, one lab you can set up for IoT, one lab you can set up for network, and everything is online. We let the student play around, because if we don't give them the infrastructure, they will not learn. As of now, whatever cyber awareness or education or trainings we are doing, they're all classroom trainings and on PPTs, right, or on books. But the infrastructure available to the students is very limited. If the student is keen to learn something, he will do it. But my experience is very limited when you go to these colleges. In one of the college we went in, it's a 1 year master course on cyber, and the lab was locked because kids play around, and then it's very difficult to make the machine up. So these are some of the challenges which are there, and we just have to work with various stakeholders to make it happen. And I think the last point, when I talk about encouragement and benefits of the entrepreneurship, although METI has a scheme where if you come up with a proposal, they will fund it on a cyber. I think they have some budgets around it. I don't know how many of the startup have used that particular budgets. I don't know, but apart from that, the point which I touched upon is that how can we give them the experience? How can we give them the platform which they can use on this? So these are, I listed down a lot of examples which can be done in all the four tracks. First one we said securing the government. The second one we said creating a secure ecosystem for the businesses. Capacity building for the end user, citizens. And the fourth one we said was on the technology and the capacity and capability from the resource and technology perspective. So these are some of the thought I had, and happy to take questions and discuss on these.
As far as if we will see about the state of Rajasthan, like they have done a wonderful job in terms of digitization. Right, most of the services for the common people, they have launched and they are using it because it has been driven from the top. Right, that secretary was very much, they have developed a very good innovation center in the Jaipur. There they have promote to these startups. They are giving them, they make a body, they analyze what is the prospects of that particular startup, and then they review every 2 months, and then they provide them the support space, and then projects and mentorship for doing something, right? So it is totally the person driven, But that need to be system driven, right? So, but as far as India is concerned, as digitization in the state has been just initiated a couple of years ago, right? But the fast it is moving, every states are moving. As far as you talk about Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, these states are again trying to match up the pace of other states. So now the things has to be enforced with all that has to be made in terms of cybersecurity, because if it would not be handled at this point of time, it will create mess.